Anas, Anas, microphone.
Aspetta. Okay. Can you hear me? Okay, no, okay. Oh yeah, I'm in Ambata now.
No, no problem. Thank you.
There is someone, I think Igor, maybe as I ask to mute the microphone to those are not talking and not speaking. So there is some noise.
Okay. Did you hear me? Yes, I turn on microphone.
No, I see. Maybe I guess in Igor room someone talking. Okay. So there is some. Oh, finally I know your voice, Anya. After 1,000 hours of messaging on our stuff. Mohammed is here, okay. Okay, just let's wait 5 minutes. And, so. Well. Then we start. That now in Ulaanbaatar is the COVID outbreak. It is the worst time since it started. It's like 3,000 cases per day. So there is a lockdown. I cannot go to my project area. Actually, I'm waiting already a month and a half ago, supposed to be there, but cannot move from the province, from Ulaanbaatar. So I have to wait a little bit to let new data. And let me let you know. Okay, wait, yeah. Let's wait until 8:05, just to talk together, then we can start. It's a nice location, man. From the car, is outdoor is nice. Cannot hear, you are muted.
It is a quiet place now for me.
I understand you because you know, I'm in the same situation. If you see some doll outside, it's not my toys. I'm just, I mean, around there is some doll, but it's not, you know, the daughter. Okay. Here there is Ilya. Well, hi. Hello, nice to meet you. Yeah. Okay. So.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Hello. Добрый вечер.
Yeah. Добрый.
Добрый день. Добрый день. Добрый день. У нас вечер.
Да.
Okay. We are just waiting a couple of minutes and start. I hope you can hear me clearly. My accent is a bit like a godfather because I'm from that side of Italy. So don't be scared. Don't be impressed for that. Hope you understand me. Okay, let's at least introduce the webinar that is and later we start the presentation. With Anya, we discussed about the opportunity to do some webinar, mainly a face-to-face to present the projects are implementing in the sixth region, and then try to understand what is the strength, the gap need to be filled in terms of knowledge, so research, conservation methodology, and then we can make later some workshop trying to help each other. For sure, we'll do likely a webinar every 3 weeks, more or less, and one for each region. Today is the day of Mongolia. I must be the brave of giving the start, no? And actually, the other were a bit in the field. So even should be another couple of projects in Mongolia, I will present only mine because the other were not available for some reason. Now I think it's more or less time we can start. Yeah, just I share the screen and then wait a minute. And like this, are you able to see the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Do you see the cat or? Okay. Now just a minute and then we can start. Let's see. Okay. It's 8:05. I think we can start. Well, my project is named Status and Ecology and Conservation of Pallas Cat in Mongolia outside the protected area. The institute implementing the project are Wildlife Initiative, which is a very new international NGO I founded. Because in the last 10 years, I worked in Mongolia with a grassroots NGO called the Green Initiative, but it was more about the cleaning environment. So since I come to help, it turns to biodiversity conservation, and then was needed a new, better structured NGO also to facilitate the projects, to find some funding support more easily, and all the structure a bigger NGO can have. So in the project, Wildlife Initiative is the leader of the project, the leading institution, conceiving the research and conservation, the project basically, and involving all the stakeholders, find the funding, and whatever was needed to implement the project. The Southern Illinois University provide expertise because we collaborate with a group of specialists in cats, big and small, and plus they cannot provide the funding, but provide some equipment. They provided all the camera traps, which are always 50 cameras, sometimes stolen and we replace it, but they provide those cameras. And the Mongolia Academy of Science is the local government institution that supported the project. Also provide some student from the National University doing the thesis with our data, come with us in the field, we train him on the methodologies and also in the analysis. So we have researchers and conservationists from three continents, North America, Europe, Asia. And we have the MAN working group as a partners, which is more than a formal partnership, because our idea is that all of us, I mean, possible, all the members of the group who implemented the project, sharing their data, at least in terms of detection events or the recent funding, because to have fresh data to understand the current status of the cat before the waiting publication, that between data filtering analysis and journal requirement can wait 2 years. So we can have a big data set of data on at least on Pallas Cat, and then on that can be easy for us understand what is going on across the globe. And the supporting partners since 2021 are Natura Sea, which is a company who do sustainable agriculture, and AGU, who do trekking shoes. So they give us the amount of a small grant, more or less, but that's allow us to keep the project. Since from 2020, we didn't have funding, and it's not sustainable from own pocket, let's say like that. So the project area is in the South Tuv province of Mongolia, which is the here where there is the spot, the red spot here. Is a mountainous area in the steppe with a lot of caves, good potential dance for Pallas Cat everywhere, more or less. As you see, is that mountain here you see, which is surrounded by steppe. And the elevation gradient is from 1,200 to 1,715 on the peak of this mountain. And around there is also sand dunes area, small lakes. The main activity is the herding of nomadic livestock. Unfortunately, now 10 kilometers far from this mountain, there is a new mining. Already there is a problem with the electric cushion with the birds, a lot die. I hope it will not, cause too much trouble. Let's see. So about the threatened area, not for sure the habitat. As I told you, that's is full of potential dens. As you see, is an area around approximately 50 kilometers square of mountains, or at least a rocky outcrop on the top of the hill, very suitable for Palasket. Human can be a trouble because there is a little hunting, sometimes with the purpose, sometimes by mistake because they try to trap mammoth and trap Palasket. And then there is a dog that local people told us kill every year. Generally is mother with the kittens in the den, the maternal den. And also in general is a bit of trouble, this dog, because we have the herders divided the territory according to the carrying capacity of the system. So each 4 kilometers square, more or less, you find a ger, a Mongolian ger, with a family. And each one has one or two dogs patrolling all that area. So more or less, the area is all covered by dog activity. And as you see here, I don't know if you know the bankar, the Mongolian dog, but it doesn't look like a bankar. I understand the camera sometimes change a bit the shape, but I think it's not that the case. To me, that's look like a wolf painted by Mongolian dog, because there's not is actually half of this in the Mongolian dog, the shoulder, all the body shape is like wolf. Anyway, we have evidence of hybridization in this area. So this trouble of dog is extended to all the system, more or less. So. The aim, we have three main aims for the project, is understanding the Palasket population dynamic, because that's the main thing, understand the status in the area. Across the seasons, across the years, we already, I will tell you later, estimate the population during a single season. And then understanding the Palasket ecology in terms of activity overlap and with the co-predators and prey, and also co-occurrence, in terms of spatial co-occurrence with co-predator and prey, involving local community. Here I am with this guy with the children. He really care that I do a photo with the children, because of being luck. Surely he doesn't know my story, because if not, will not ask it, but I hope it will work. So we involve the local people, and our purpose in the future will be protect the maternal den from dog. At least that will be also some important step. The main methods we are using are the camera tracking, since you can obtain a lot of useful data from camera traps, like we will see. And I have also more experience, since already from 2015, I put over 100 camera traps across Mongolia. So in terms of data filtering analysis, also I have quite experience in this environment. Then GPS tracking collar we are not using yet, because we found something suitable for a small cat, but the minimum order was over $20,000, which we cannot afford now. But we will do in the future, maybe finding something cheaper if possible. And then we want the herders to become researchers, because I selected this photo, which is not related to the project, is in the project area. You see here, but it was a project about inland water crustaceans, where we found in that area like six new species unknown to science. So you see here father, mother, daughter, and son, all very interested to these crustaceans. And that's the point I would like to develop, make the people interested to their environment. Yes, motivate with some money when it will be possible, whatever. Yes, it's okay, it's fine. Involve them directly, but make them curious. That's happened something even funny when, for instance, I put the live trap for the rodents. They think already I'm very strange to do that, because why you are catching the rodents? when I make them free release, they think I'm just crazy. It was not only trap, but even later release. So that's, I think, is that. But somehow that work, because is a certain point to say, okay, so what are you doing? Why you are doing that? We are doing that for this reason. It's important to know what happened through the rodent psychology, that already they have an idea, speak with the friend about what we are doing. So involving the local people is, of course, a crucial point in the project. We will see later how we want to involve them. And rise local people awareness. I mean, not only those people living in the study area, also people around, because then these people around go in the mammals of hot spot to hunt. So that's also an important part to raise the local people. For local, will it mean a much larger area than those where we put the camera traps and do our conservation project. So a little history and background of the project, very short. In 2014, 2017, I wrote a few cameras, less experience. That's a very important point. I discussed with Tania sometime in private chat. In 2014, I put 4 or 5 cameras, but basically left unattended across the year. But basically that was on ungulates, passage points. So I thought whatever passed from there, living there, passed from there, I would get. It was not true. In the same study area in 2017, I did an intensive survey, single season, put in 25 cameras in summer 2017. I had 2 detection of Pallascat, but again, using more or less wider passage point that the general I use by wolf or ungulates. And in 2019, I met Jim Sanderson, who kindly invited me to visit Ot Bayir Buyal, I still in Mongolia, Buyan Delger site study in the Eastern Mongolia. And there I noticed that was some problem with den. You see cats in between 2 rocks, like even open sky, just 2 vertical rocks inside the cat. So really had some problem with the habitat. Then after, how to say, catching only do detection of Pallascat with the large efforts of sampling. Plus this situation there, I felt like I had to understand more about it and see what is going on. Can we help somehow? So in 2019, I did a preliminary survey in the same area, more or less in the same period of the survey I did in 2017 in a single season. And with the same sampling efforts, same number of camera, the same number of day, and got 48 independent detection of Pallascat. This time different than 2017, I put the camera in front of the marking point, or even inside. When I see a lot of rock and a room where was some scats, basically a fox, because a Pallascat is difficult to distinguish in a place full of scat of fox, wherever, put the camera there inside. So this is in this photo, I don't know if you see the arrows here, the cursor. In this photo, you see a Pallascat getting in one of this room. And actually that was a good strategy to get a lot of photo detection. From 2019 to today, in the truth is from 2019 to today, we got a lot of data, which can be considered extraordinary because there are hundreds of independent detection of Pallascat across the year. Later we will see better in the detail this result. So from the first season, I mean, the preliminary survey, let's say, we analyzed the data and made the first estimation of Pallascat and studied the activity pattern of the cat for those period. It's a 2 preliminary survey, let's say. And then that is published in the Wildlife Free Research. Another one is in press, is accepted, not published yet, about activity overlap between mesocarnivore and prey in the Central Mongolia steppe. We will see now on the data, in detail. For the density estimation, we use the first data of preliminary survey to understand how to set the camera and also to have a sunket to compare it to, in order to improve the identification. Then there was a first preliminary period from May to August, and then a second period from August to end of November, where we use 21 cameras in the first period, 45 like a double camera per station, two camera per station in the second period. And we got 180 images with 54 detection the first period, 304 images with 99 independent detection events in the second period. And we identified four cats, four individuals in the first period and 12 individuals in the second period in 44 detections, because some of detection was discarded because we were not able to identify the cat. For that independent detection events, I mean a span of time of 30 minutes between two captures of the same species in the same site, okay? If we get more than two captures in 30 minutes in the same site for the same species, we discard that data. So, as I told you, I put in front of marking site or inside the rooms that I use it as marking sites. So, I feel some noise from someone. I try to mute at the moment. It's okay. We can go ahead. Okay. As I told you, we use this marking site. So when the cat get in, we are able to see the face, the front part of the cat, and compare the spots or the stripes. We are here. So are basically able to compare and identify the individuals. We estimate the population 15.2 individuals per 100 meter square, that is in the high end of the range of previous estimate. Our estimate is particularly rigorous because we use a spatial species capture recapture, which is recognized among the most rigorous method to estimate population. And we also estimate on range, basically based on activity center, extracted by camera traps data. And we found an home range of 11.9 kilometer square per cat, which is matched with the female Pallas cat home range, but is smaller than non-estimate for male. To be honest, this estimate on range probably is less accurate than those made by covering. In the same work, we compared the activity of Pallas cat between the summer period, which is end of May and end of August, I mean Mongolian summer period, and also from end of May to end of November. As you see, here is a crepuscular in summer, while in let's say autumn is the peak. I wrote here peak at midday, and the truth is around 11, yes. But anyway, the peak is during the morning. Remember this peak here in the autumn. In the other study that now is in press at the moment, we compared the activity overlap between Pallas cat and copredator, which are red fox and beach marten, and five prey, which are potential prey at least, which are Mongolian silver ball, Brent's vole, Mongolian gerbil, Siberian marmots, and Darien pika. Among all of this overlap, only the overlap with the fox and with the Mongolian silver ball are significant, because even as different, but the density of fox and silver ball is large enough that they are active more or less always. So that's probably the reason. And pika is the main prey, but is very abundant. We think that the ballast cat no need to adapt to shape their activity according to the peak activity, because anyway is available. So we don't know, coming back to the other one, what could be the reason of changing the activity here, because clearly can be everything, can be because of change the abundance of some prey, or the opposite, can decrease the abundance of a competitor, can be related to co-predator, predator, or just the weather condition. We don't know exactly. One of the hypotheses we just are thinking about is that during this period, which is more or less corresponding to autumn, in the area there is a huge herd of Mongolian gazelle, and we found a huge increase of wolf. We take always 5-6 detection of wolf, independent detection events of wolf. In this period, we found like 45 independent detection events of wolf. And another hypothesis we cannot exclude is that the wolf affect the activity of fox, which in summer is exactly like this one, the right one. This is the palace cat, but in summer the fox is exactly this peak at this time. And in turn, maybe the fox can change in the activity, can affect also the palace cat, since who take that niche, the temporal niche of the fox. We don't know, but we have enough data to analyze. And now we are start analyzing this data for 1 year. So these are the results. About this last data of 2019-2020, 1 year, we had at the moment just a raw analysis for raw descriptors, like independent detection events. And as you see, the most detected species across the year was the Ocotona daurica, with the Daurian pika, which is the main prey known for palace cat. The Articulus americanus, which is the Mongolian silver vole. We are not surprised, because that's living in the same habitat of palace cat, between the rocks. And then the palace cat, the carnivore with the most detection, but style study was tailored for that, so that's not really a surprise as well. As you see, in 1 year we had using an average of 42-43 cameras, we got 550 independent detection of palace cat. Then the fox is also quite spread, using the same shelter, the same marking points, obviously. Also good that Marmotta sibirica has enough detection, considering that it is a global endangered species. And then many other species. About the livestock, sheep and goats and horses are the most spread, the most detected among that, that area. And even from small pastoral forms like this Lucina calliope in the photo, we got over 60 species birds. So from some of them, some inference can be even done. So the next steps are to involve the 9 family, at least we count the 9 family. It's not very easy to count all the family in Mongolia because they move, but should be 9 families living in the study area. Because as I said previously, we want they become researchers. I wish to go in the field only a time for this purpose. The other time I want that the funding I spend to go in the field are shared between the local people. Each one will have 3-4 camera, which they must take care. Just replace the SD card, the full with the empty one, the new batteries, give it to a focal point, and that's the way I want to run the project forever, basically. And so, of course, we try to find the maternal dense spot. Is not very easy, but through the camera traps, we have already some good input. And I hope with the coloring, we also will find the main spot to protect, maybe fence with some dog-proof coral, something like that. We have to study some design or something very suitable, but that is a crucial point in my opinion. Rise local people awareness. As I said, all the people living around going that area to hunt. And basically what we want to do is use the experience of the people we will involve. Then Seth must do the presentation in the workshop, saying what they are doing, their experience, their results, what they found, what is important and what is not. So that's our purpose. Actually, these steps should be implemented already this year, but it is a problem of budget because we use the implemented the project through ecotourism in 2019. Which is not really ecotourism, is internship of a foreign student. I teach how to use the camera traps, analyze. They come to Mongolia, do it in the field, and pay some a certain amount so that with a very small group, 4 or 5 person, we can already, in two expedition, we can already fill all the cost for camera trapping. So with the sponsor supposed to, involve these people and pay the cost that to run this step. But unfortunately, due to COVID, I don't have available those money for ecotourism. I must use this to keep to collect the data with camera trapping. So once COVID leave us a little break, we can restart with ecotourism and start with these further steps. So thank you. Now you can unmute your phone. You can, okay. You can do all the questions you wish to do. And you can even, there is a reaction, you can raise your hand. I'm here.
Thank you. Maybe I'll start with one question. You have lots of images. Do you have some software to help you to sort them, or are you actually going through them, like sorting everything by eye, or do you have a software that can help you either sort by species, or I don't think we're yet at where we can look at the individual ID. I think that's a little bit away. But...
Yeah, no, I for this first phase, I use the open software called the Wild ID that give me very raw matrix. That I prefer because later for me is easier to work on R on that raw matrix. Actually, from the new data, I mean, from those I described with the 550 capture of Palascat the last 12 months, 1920, we will use CamTrap R, which is also free software, is less friendly, but actually can help because you know R has a lot of trouble with the formats, something you can add from Excel to R, there is already trouble. So the point is use CamTrap R and entry the photo already in CamTrap R, go further with CamTrap R. We rename first the photos with a program for renaming so that each photo has a unique name, including coding the name with the sampling, which is sampling consider a sampling when we replace the SD, no? So restart counting the photo, we say sampling once, and then with the project, little code, 2 letters for the project, the date, the program extract the date from the photo and the number of image. So always is automatically this process from the rename program. So after renaming, we enter the photos on CamTrap R and work further with that. Thanks, Mohamed. Just one query. Information about activity overlap with the dog. Okay, the Neraj, I ask apologize if I pronounce that. For sure, I pronounce the name wrong. So say, just a query and information about the activity overlap with the dogs. Now, we do not have enough data of dog directly, but I think we will try, not sure, but let's see, to consider the presence of sheep and goat as an indirect presence of dog, because where there is dog and sheep, in the pasture, in the grazing area, for sure there is a dog, because in all that area the herder leaves the dog with the sheep. Actually, in the wild he does something else. Maybe he come back to home, take the water for the animal in the evening or whatever. But the dog is surely always there. So we have to try to understand if we can use that those data that we have enough capture to infer about the effect of dog to palace cat. That's what we will try.
Okay. Could you expand a bit? So the main threat is that they're actually killing the palace cats, right? So they're free-ranging dogs that are either chasing them or and actually physically probably killing them as well, right?
Yeah, we had the information like generic about that free-ranging dog, sea cats, and that it's happened. That's what is told us by elders. But another problem is that they probably spot easily the dens, the maternal dens. In that way, we think for the mother is much more difficult to move and move also the offspring with there. And that's also happened. Like personally, last year, I heard that want to show us a den of palace cat. When we reached there, it was nothing. And then he said, I saw it the day before yesterday, but yesterday my dog was around, probably he did it. That's can happen. I think the solution, there is no one solution. It will be wonderful. But little solution that can reduce that 10%, the killing, another reducing the 30%, another reducing the 20%, somehow can help. With the activity overlap, we can draw these herders. I mean, after we involve even paying a little fee to our project, maybe they can move half hour later for the sheep or for before. And that's already means bring the dog in that place after or before the peak of activity of palace cat there. Other way can be a simple collar with the bell to the dog. Maybe they give it 3 seconds to the cat to get in a hole and then escape. I don't know, probably all this percentage, each of this action can help. I think the main point is first have a strong evidence on what we can do, so on what is the trouble, so that the mistake on the conservation nation will be reduced. That's our approach. So really make efforts to understand what is needed and reduce our mistake on the follow step. That's what we are trying to understand. And for sure now we will start when lockdown is stopped here, we'll start also to involve more the local elders with this.
Thank you.
Okay. Here another question. Okay, gonna trap sites. Interesting. Ilya asking, could say please, do you collect information on dead cats in your working area? In case of that specifically, no. I found only a skeleton of palace cat, but was already gone. So we do not have, didn't find any dead cat. Then there is also Igor asking, did you use or plan to use lures to attract palace cats on camera trap sites? No. Actually, in that preliminary survey where I tried to understand it, after 2017 with the two only detection, my question was, but the palace cat is here or this one are passing by? So to understand if it was a population, I say, okay, put some Valeriana, something like that, generally cats like an experience like that. Instead, we got the beach marten beating with the head of the camera like a crazy, want to eat the camera because of Valeriana. The palace cat doesn't care at all. Then after that sampling, anyway, we put the camera in front of marking sites, or even inside this big room among the rock of marking site, and we understood no need any lure that can bias the data. So we prefer don't put that, we have enough capture. So the secret is, the key point is the marking sites. Even you do not find the sketch of cat, if there is a cat, go in the same marking site of fox, in the same marking of beach martin. So if you put the camera there, likely if a cat is there, it will go there. So that's paid a lot in terms of detection events, because you saw we had a lot of capture.
Can I ask a question, Claudio?
Sure.
Yeah, thank you. That was a nice presentation and good experiences. So in this such a high density of polecat in Mongolia, how many polecat do you estimate to be killed by people per year in the study area?
We didn't do this kind of estimation at the moment, but...
Okay. Don't you have any rough estimation? Because I want to just compare with our situation, that how many would be too much to lose per year? Because we don't know the population. Sometimes we see people killing or capturing or confiscated. So the amount of knowledge and information we have are from our study areas are much less. So just trying to figure out when they are in danger in our situation.
Okay, well, unfortunately, I cannot help now just to give an answer, right? But okay. I think, I don't know, for the people I communicate until now that are more or less half, six of this 9-10 families, like half at least told me that their dog, maybe one this year, one last year, or something like that, not counting systematically the, in a precise time range, right? But all of them, more than half of them, 3-4 told me they experienced the dog killed the cat. I think, of course, now when I start the next step of the project involving all this family there, which is not that expensive, that's another important point. You think that when I go there for the camera traps to retrieve the camera 4 times per year, I spend around 1,000 euro, 1,500 euro each time. Driver, petrol, food, pay the care of host me like that. If I just divide it to these people, for them is around, each is around 1,200,000 Tugric, which is the same amount they have each, more than that, is like $1,200 per year, which is the same amount they have for cashmere sales in 1 year, more or less. Okay, of course, there is a range from 1,000 to 3,000, but already, I mean, is an important contribution. And I think from that time, they will be more, of course, more motivated to share the information. I think at that time, I will do a questionnaire, a detailed questionnaire, to also understand all these details. And there, maybe we can start to make some estimation. At least in a range of time. Okay, I will take a note, I will let you know.
Okay, and my thank you. And my second question is somehow related to what Igor asked. So you have a high density of polecat, so you expect to see too many marking places. Do you have any experience from polecat population where the density is not that much high, so we might not see too much marking site, or do we see too many marking site in those places as well? How do you think it's related to the density?
To be honest, I don't have a great experience, because the only other work I did in this case as a co-author, because I left the data manager from another group, is working with me with the snow leopard on the Altai mountain. And we collect, since we sampled the same sampling period, during spring, more or less, in 4 different years, we merge the data and try to understand how the co-occurrence and the activity work. Cannot estimate the density there in that case. And there was just by luck, probably was enough abundant to pass also from a larger passage. The point is, with this methodology of setting the camera on the marking sites, I do not have another comparison, another area to compare, because I can tell you I sampled the other area, but I didn't sample it in this way. So in the same area, in a different way, I took only 2 detections, with the same efforts, with the same efforts, the same period, same number of camera, everything, I got 48. So it's easy to say there is a palace cat in Bayanundu, which is most of the area, but it's very scarce. We don't know even if it's a population because maybe two passing by. Then when you change the system to sampling and make a specific for the species, you understand that was not treated at all, but you have to protect them because it's a population source probably for the surrounding area. So that's is interesting, and to be honest, is another way to extend this project to other area, probably across Mongolia. I think with the other already are implementing with the different methods, like in the Eastern Mongolia. I talked already with Bahir last year, saying that later or before I will go with the camera and then we can do that. And I think in some crucial points, spot in the Mongolia that can function as a stepping stones or as population sources in some important area, we can how to say, do again this the same method in this most important area. That's what I think.
Thank you.
Also that I will let you know. Okay, thanks for the question. No, if there is other questions, the lure we answered. That cat will answer. And okay, Claudio, this is, I guess, Anna. Yeah, I was lucky to start in habitat. Ah, okay. Anna say I was lucky to start in habitat with Otting for the mountain. I think so, yes. Honestly, when habitat is not very suitable, it's more difficult to find a large population. Even I can tell you that I don't have direct experience, but in Mongolia, for instance, the other project is mentioned in the website of Manual Working Group of Bayir and wife, is not such suitable in terms of habitat. Even Nutsok, I think, with the Stephen Ross, I'm not sure for that. So if it's not as Escapology, but I think also in that project they implemented at the early 2012 or something like that, the data collection, was a very scarce habitat where basically were four or five holes in the whole area. So they go straight to the that also knowing that that was the only potential then for the cat, but they found it. So probably there is many causes can concur to disappearing of palace cat from an area, from the habitat, but even habitat is scarce. If you have prey, they may go there. So until there is probably the prey, if they are not hunted, they will find a way. That's what they think. Then of course, if in my case you have a prey habitat, like Anna said, I was unlucky. That's it.
Claudia, I was thinking, you know, you've been so successful and you learned so much about what are good marking sites and what are good trap sites. So it could be very nice, perhaps, if you could document this, you know, maybe for like some type of a manual to help others taking photographs and maybe, you know, writing something about it. Because it could be like others come to an area and they just set the cameras in the wrong place and you just don't get the results that you could if you had your experience to build on. So I think that that could be nice. And I know Essan is working on a manual on monitoring of the caps and perhaps of the palace cats, and maybe you could maybe collaborate.
A paragraph from that, is that?
Yeah, on you know, these are good sites. Typically good sites are characterized by the following and maybe some photographs. I think that could be very helpful. So
yeah, that's some photograph, of course, also the sites could be good. Yeah, that's what make put in the wrong side. It is what I did in the add only to detection. So of course that's happened to me, can happen to any other probably who doesn't have experience like I was in 2020. But I agree. Actually, it will be done in a few months, couple of months. A lot of the deadline, of course, but that would be possible. I will contact team and then say maybe a chapter or a paragraph with the photos and description of the detail. Yeah, would be useful. That's the point of the webinar, is to understand what is the strength and gap and then try to help each other.
Yeah, like you say, I mean, everybody would do the same in the beginning, put them in the wrong place. And, you know, it takes years like for you. And if you have that information, you can share that. That would be perfect, I think. So thanks. Yeah, sure. Great.
Yeah, thanks for the idea. Okay, aspetta. I need to quickly run another meeting. Oh, man. Okay. Hi, Mohamed. And then, so it could be rocks with the niche. Rocks, walls. So I didn't understand well the question from Anna. Say so successful location could be rocks with niches and rocks, walls, or and picas. However, somehow across all this rock, basically there is a pica or wall. That's the point. Because actually their prey species are quite spread. Population, the abundance depend more from the population dynamic. So from the their cycle. For instance, we found the Bent's vole, which is not recognized as a vole living in the rock, the most abundant among the vole in the preliminary survey, because we reached the places in spring, and that was like every meters, everywhere for thousands of kilometers, you see a Bent's vole, all two, three. There was a population, unbelievable that population outbreak. Probably they pushing until reaching the rock. Even under the cliff, we found a lot of dead, counting hundreds of dead Bent's vole under the cliff. So I think that's depend from the cycles, but pika and Mongolian silver vole, which lives there always, there you can expect basically in any rock where you can find the ballast cap, there is for sure some pika. So okay, yeah, no question. Yeah, it's a fact. Yeah, but it's a fact that you will find also the prey in any rock you find, at least in Mongolia, is they are quite spread in the Mongolian steppe. Okay.
Yo, I have a question, if I can.
Yes, of course.
Thank you so much. It was a really, really great talk. You mentioned that you are working in non-protected areas.
Yes.
And I wonder if there's any corridor between protected areas and your study site, and how the human settlements actually located inside your study region. I really would like to see if there's any, I don't know, map which can give us this whole idea about your study sites better, and especially about human settlements because of the high density of Pallasgat that you could identify there. I'm really wondering about that.
So I understood the first part of the question where you talk about the corridor with protected area. Okay, you're asking.
Exactly. I really would like to see your study site. I mean, I really would like to have a better picture of that, how the human settlements located inside your study area and how it's connected with protected areas, if there's any around that.
Okay, first of all, yes, it is a non-protected area. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that it's one of the places, more farther than protected area. I mean, the closest one is in the Ustè National Park. Now, mm-hmm. I will try to share with you the Google Earth, so I will show you in a few seconds where it is. So. Okay. I promise I will do a report only on the project, so with the details, so all the stuff you can be satisfied. But in the while, can you see the Google Earth map? Okay.
Not yet. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Allora, here we are in Mongolia. There is Ulaanbaatar is the city here. You go 160 kilometers in the side, the southwest, more or less. Approximately here, there is the Ustai National Park. So we are around the 100 kilometers south of the Ustai National Park. But I can say it's not connected, of course, 100 kilometers for a little cat. So, as you see, sand dunes, some wetland. Here, where you see all this gear is the okay, summer and winter gear. Are not so many inhabitants there, but they move. So I put a mark point on summer and winter gear. So only some of that are together present in a certain period. No? As you see, this is a Rocchiera, mountain area. All around you have other gears, more or less both in the steppe, in the mountain, there is one gear each 2 kilometers on the straight line. And I cannot say there is a true corridor between this national park, because to the Ustai there is the Tulu River, which is a river where water flew across the year. So it's not something that a palace cat can easily cross. And anyway, it's far. I mean, 100 kilometers for snow leopard, maybe. To Palasket, I guess you need a motorway, not a corridor to reach there. So, about the interaction with the human is what I told you. There is basically a herding activity. The hunting is not very spread for Palasket, but there is still someone putting traps for mammoth. And there is people even from Ulaanbaatar come here to hunt because it's full of, quite abundant of ungulates and wolf. So they go there to hunt this species. So there is a certain disturbance, but basically I think the strength of this project is that this area is really very well representative for Mongolia. So what you find here, you find across Mongolia. Probably the natural system here is particularly suitable for Palasket. So not necessarily here you will find the same situation of here, maybe less abundance or whatever. But in terms of the eco-social system, okay, what you find here, you find for at least 70% of Mongolian territory. So that's why I say that's really can help. It can be extended to other important area because is really representative for Mongolia. So whatever is the bad impact on human, somehow at the moment we have abundant population of Palasket. So we have to try don't lose this population because for sure is a source for the surrounding area. But some other way we assist to how human presence not necessarily means extinction of a erosive species. At the end, you see with the traditional activity, not too intensive number of life of people and a using of pasture land. Somehow you have a prey, somehow you have a cat, and then it survives. That is a good point, I think. I hope I answered to your questions now.
Yeah. Thank you. Perfect. Thank you so much, Claudio. Nice job.
Thank you. Okay. So if there are any other questions? Okay. How much passed? Okay, already 1 hour more or less passed. If there is no other question, but I'm still open, I invite all of you to the next webinar that will present the project implementing in Russia. It will be in July. We will see when our colleague will be available to present their project. So, thank you very much to attend the presentation, to know a bit more about my project, and I will keep you updated for any step, promise. Okay, thank you very much. See you.
Thank you.
The next. Bye. See you.